سبيل الدموع سبيل مريح تنا أدى يا صاحي كي تستريح
نور على مر الزمان تألقا وأضاء للدنيا طريقا مشرقا وهدى.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. We continue on. Last week we spoke about the thing that people say all the time, you guys make everything haram, or you guys make our lives hard, or you guys, everything that we do, you guys say, no, it's not allowed, it's not allowed, it's not allowed. And alhamdulillah, we explained that aspect. This week, inshallah, Azza wa Jal, will come from the what the author has written, that Allah Azza wa Jal has made the halal so vast in our life. And the reasons why when we speak about the things which are haram. And we don't sit there giving a comprehensive list every single week about the things that are halal. The author, Hafidhullah, says, Allah, who is merciful towards his slaves, has permitted innumerable good things of many kinds. He has not described the permitted things in detail because they are so many. In contrast, he has described the prohibitions in detail because they are limited, so that we will be aware of them and can avoid them. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَقَدْ فَصَّلَ لَكُمْ مَا حَرَّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ إِلَّا مَا اضْطُرِرْتُمْ إِلَيْهِ. And he has explained to you in detail what he has forbidden to you, except what you do under compulsion or necessity. The first point we take from this is that Allah Azza wa Jal, he is merciful towards his slaves. Allah Azza wa Jal, رَحِيمٌ بِعِبَادِ. This is one aspect that a person who complains about the deen, or the hardship of the deen, or that you make everything haram, this is an aspect he hasn't understood from the deen. He hasn't understood who Allah Azza wa Jal is. Once a person knows that Allah Azza wa Jal, and he understands, not just knows the name, but he understands that Allah Azza wa Jal is merciful. Yahi, what does that mean, Allah Azza wa Jal is merciful? Or a person knows Allah Azza wa Jal is al-Hakim, Allah Azza wa Jal is wise. What does that mean? What's the practical implication of that? When a person knows that Allah Azza wa Jal is al-Latif, Allah is soft with his slaves, what impact should that have on my iman, on my life, on my Islam? You will find that if he properly understands who Allah Azza wa Jal is, his life will change without doubt. When you know that Islam was given by Allah, and Allah is the all-knowing, and Allah is the all-wise, and Allah is the one who's soft with his slaves, and Allah Azza wa Jal is the most merciful to his slaves, can you complain about what Allah Azza wa Jal gives you? Of course you can't. Impossible. When you go to a doctor, and this is a parable that we give, and it shows you our limited understanding of the reality of this life and the hereafter. When you go to a doctor, you know that doctor is deficient. You know the doctor is a human being just like you. You know that doctor, he's maybe studied 5, 6, 7, 10 years. You know that doctor is prone to make mistakes. You know there's other doctors. You know all of this and more. But when you go to the doctor and he recommends something for you, do you sit there and question? Do you sit there and are you upset at what he says? If the doctor, your GP, tells you to go to a specialist, let's say you've got back problems, and that specialist, and you get to it, he says, look, your job is, your problem is specific. You need to go to a chiropractor, you need to go to a physiotherapist, for example. You get to the specialist. You went to the specialist, why? Because the one that you trust, which is your doctor, said you need to get him in order to fix your problem. You went to the physiotherapist. You're lying there on the bed. The physiotherapist puts his thumbs and puts his elbows into you and it hurts you. But what's going through your mind? I need to put up with the pain, even if only for a limited time, because I know the end result is good. I need to put up with the pain. I know it's for a limited time, because the end result is that I'm going to be fixed, I'm going to be cured, I'm going to get better. When you go, you see some people, for example, the doctor says, Habibi, your cholesterol is too high. If you continue this way, it's going to lead to heart disease. So you are no longer allowed to eat this particular food, at least for a few weeks, till your cholesterol drops. So you, for example, you invite him to a barbecue, and he said, Tafadhal, you want meat? And he says, no. I'm not allowed to have. Why? Say, because I went to the doctor, my cholesterol was high. He said, stay away from red meat at least for about a month until your cholesterol goes down. So he changes his whole life, even though It might cause him some hardship, but he changes his whole life because he knows that the doctor knows better than him, and the doctor has his best interest at heart, and the end result is going to be good. Don't we believe that and more about Allah Azza wa Jal? Don't you trust Allah more than the doctor? Don't you believe Allah is better than the doctor? Don't you believe Allah is more wise than the doctor? So why do you not submit your affairs to Allah regarding the matters of religion? You know Allah's merciful. Allah's not going to give you in the religion hardship. You know Allah's wise. You know He's only going to make as legislation in the Sharia that which is best for you. Instead of a person sitting and complaining and oofing and ifing regarding the Sharia of Allah Azza wa Jal. Accept the Sharia. Because this is from Allah Azza wa Jal. And you should know this about Allah. The specific attribute and name that the author Hafizullah chose was Ar-Rahim. Why as well Ar-Rahim in particular? Ar-Rahim, when you read Quran, Bismillah, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. What's the difference between Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim? What's the difference? Tafaddalu. Rahman is the attribute, Rahim is the action. Now you want to get into a full aqidah lesson. Forget the that and al-fa'al, forget that for a second. The other explanation for the difference between Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim. Good, this is another expression that Allah Ta'ala gave. In Arabic, Rahman is the same wazn as fa'alan. Fa'alan, if you speak to any, for example, Arab, huh? He's not even a proper Arab. But yalla Ahmed, yani Lebanese background, so you accepted. If you're angry, in Arabic if you're angry, za'alan. Angry, ghadban. Ana ghadban. If you're thirsty, achan. If you're hungry, jawan. If you're upset, za'alan. All right, you find it's all fa'alan, like Rahman. This emotion or this feeling, it comes and it goes. It comes and it goes. So if I'm angry, ghadban, that ghadab, that anger is going to go. So it's finished. Achan, I'm only achan when I'm thirsty. Once I've quenched my thirst, it's gone. I'm not called achan anymore. Rahman is not one of the traits of Allah that they say will last forever. In the sense that Allah in this dunya is Ar-Rahman for everyone and everything. Isn't Allah merciful even to the disbelievers? Those who disbelieve in Allah, those who curse Allah, those who say that Allah doesn't even exist, those who purposely try and fight the deen of Allah, doesn't Allah still give them water and give them drink and give them family and give them health? This is Allah's rahmah for them in this dunya. As for the trait of Allah that are always there, they're always prevalent, you find it's on the wazn of fa'il, like Rahim, like Alim, like Hakim, like Halim, like Latif. These are all in Arabic on the wazn. The wazn is the structure of the word of fa'il, meaning it's always there. Allah's always knowledgeable. Allah's always merciful to, in particular here, to the believers. Allah is always wise. Allah is always soft in His dealings, etc. So these traits never leave Allah Azza wa Jal. Or they're not there sometimes, they're not there sometimes. They are always there. Here, Rahim. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said about Allah Azza wa Jal, when he seen a woman, she was looking for her child. And she lost her child. So she's looking frantically. And you as a father, let alone a woman, you know if you've lost your child for 5 minutes, what, your heart starts pumping and you start sweating and you become scared and you think the worst and you're looking. Then she found her child. She found her child and she hugged her child. At that moment, the Prophet said to his companions, do you think that this woman would ever throw her child in the fire? The companions all said what? Of course not, Ya Rasulullah. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, verily Allah is more merciful to His slaves than this woman to her child. So a mother or a father, you as a father, when you give advice to your child, my son, this is right, my daughter, this is wrong, My son, this is the proper way. My daughter, if you commit this, then this is going to happen to you in the future. Do you give them what's best for them or what's bad for them? You give them what's best for them. And when Allah tells us in the Sharia, this is halal and this is haram. This is an obligation, this is mustahab. This is makruh. This is better to do. You should do it this way. Is Allah choosing what's best for us because he's ar-Rahim? Or is choosing what's bad for us? Without doubt, Allah is ar-Rahim. So understand the names and attributes of Allah so that you can have that practical implication that it's meant to have in your life, which is for you to worship Allah Azza wa Jal as He wants to be worshipped to the best of your ability. So he says, Allah ar-Rahim didn't tell us everything that's halal. And we're going to explain why. But he specified the haram. Why? Because the haram is limited. The haram is limited, and Allah Azza wa Jal is warning you, stay away from these things. Stay away from these things. When you want to go give your son advice, for example, your son is traveling, he's going on holiday. You don't tell your son all the things he can do. You tell him what not to do. If the car is diesel, you say, don't put petrol in there. Make sure you put diesel. If you don't want him to eat, for example, haram, you say to him, make sure you watch out, the food is halal. Make sure don't eat haram. If, for example, he's going to a place and there's a lot of haram, yani, in terms of promiscuity, etc., you say, make sure you lower your gaze. You mention the things to stay away from so that he knows, he's aware of it, so that he can stay away from it. That's what Allah done in our religion. Allah done in the Quran, in the Prophet, in the Sunnah, a lot of the things which are not allowed so that we understand them and we know them so that we can stay away from them. Otherwise, how are you meant to know the haram? How are you meant to know the haram? Then he says, Hafizahullah, but what is halal is permitted as a general principle, as long as something is good and pure. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ كُلُوا مِمَّا فِي الْأَرْضِ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا وَلَا تَطَبِعُ خُطَوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ. The part of the ayah that we want, Allah says, O mankind, eat of the lawful and pure things on earth. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, this is a rule in Islam. It is part of His mercy that He has made all the things halal in principle, except when there is an evidence, when there is a dalil to say it's haram. This is part of His generosity and bounty towards His slaves, for which we must obey Him and give praise and thanks. And we should thank Allah. The general rule is that matters of dunya are halal or haram, they're halal. This is the general rule. Anything in life to do with dunya matters, you say that in principle, is a halal or is a haram, it's halal. Can I drink Mount Franklin water? Say, is there something to say it's haram? There's nothing to say it's haram. Have you used Mount Franklin water? Can I blow my nose with a tissue? Say, is there anything to say it's haram? Then you're allowed to blow your nose, no problem. Can I use an iPhone? If there's nothing to say it's haram, then there's no problem. The matters of dunya, you're allowed to do whatever you want from the halal, unless the Sharia said it's haram, which you need a specific ayah of Quran for, or you need a specific hadith for, from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For example, you're allowed to eat every meat that you want, any type of meat you're allowed, except, for example, pig, except that which is not halal, any a cow, but it hasn't been slaughtered Islamically. Mathalan, you're allowed to drink whatever drink you want, except alcohol, except blood, for example. So you're allowed to wear for a man whatever you want, except silk. Mathalan, examples. So the Sharia has given us specifically a rule that everything is halal in terms of dunya, except that which is specified that it's haram. What about this for matters of dunya? What about for matters of deen? What about ibadah? Ibadah, it's the opposite. The general rule for ibadah is that everything is haram until proven halal. Sometimes you find people that do innovation, that do bid'ah. And they say to you, give me a dalil to say I'm not allowed to do it. Where does it say I can't celebrate the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Where does it say I can't do, you know, tawaf around the graves of the awliya? Where does it say I can't do, for example, Fatiha if I want to get married? For example, these types of things. We say, no, you're wrong in your understanding. When it comes to matters of deen, We're not allowed to do anything unless we have evidence for it. Salah, Allah said, وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةِ. Give zakah, وَأَتُوا الزَّكَاةِ. For example, hijab, يَغْدُدْنَا عَلَيْهِنَا. For example, يُدِّنَا عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِبِهِنَّ. قِيَامَ اللَّيْلِ, the ayat. Sadaqah, the ayat. Dhikr, the ayat. The virtues of Quran, the ayat, etc. You have to bring a verse to, or ayah or hadith to show that you're allowed to do it. Because the Prophet said, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ عَمَلُنَا فَهُوَ رَدْ. Whoever does an action which is not from our actions, then needs to be rejected. And you have to have an evidence. So we go back to the point of our discussion, and that's that the matters of dunya, everything is halal until proven haram. The Sheikh says something now, yani it's, I find it hilarious. The first time I read it, I laughed much more. I won't be laughing as much here. But the Sheikh says, Hafidhullah, when some people hear a detailed list of things that are haram, they become alarmed about the rules of Sharia, yani they're scared. This is due to their weak faith and poor understanding of Islam. One cannot help wondering whether these people really want to be given a list of every type of thing that is halal so that they can be convinced that Islam is easy. You know, all these people that complain, I mean, this is haram and all you speak about is haram and why you make things haram, haram, haram. Sheikh saying, do these people really want a list of everything that's halal? The Sheikh starts to give them a small list. He says, do they really need us to enumerate every type of good thing that they can rest, so that they can rest assured that Islam will not make their rights dreary? Do they want to be told that all types of meat, camel, cattle, sheep, rabbits, deer, goats, chicken, pigeons, ducks, geese, ostriches, over which the name of Allah has been mentioned is halal? And that fish and locusts, even if they're dead, are halal? Do they want to be told that vegetables, herbs, fruits, and edible seeds are halal? Do they want to be told that water, milk, honey, oil, vinegar are halal? Do they want to be told that salt, seasoning, and spices are halal? Do they want to be told that using wood, iron, sand, stones, plastic, glass, and rubber is halal? Do they want to be told that you're allowed to travel on a beast, yani a cow, I don't know if anyone rode a cow, but they want to be told that someone traveling on a donkey or on a camel or in a car or in a train or on a ship or on an aeroplane is halal? And are the people waiting for this for us? Do they want to be told that using air conditioners, fridges, washing machines, tumble dryers, mills, dough mixers, meat grinders, juicers, medical instruments, engineering tools, calculators, microscopes, telescopes, machinery for extracting water, oil and minerals, filters for purifying water, printing presses, and so on? Do they want to be told that's halal? Do they want to be told that wearing cotton, linen, wool, camel hair, fur, permitted leathers, nylon, and polyester is halal? Do they want to be told that the principle in marriage, buying, selling, sponsorship, bills of exchange, renting, professions and trades such as carpentry, metalworking, repairing machines, and tending sheep are all halal? Is this what they want? They want to give us a list of everything in the dunya to be told that all of this is halal? The Sheikh Hafidhullah says, I wonder what would happen if we were to explain all of this in detail. And then he mentions the verse, فَمَالِهَاُولَئِ الْقَوْمِ لَا يَكَادُونَ يَفْقَهُونَ حَدِيثًا. What is wrong with these people? As if they don't understand anything from speech. Yani the deen, we're explaining the deen. If you were to study the deen, they even come to the most basic of lessons. If you were to have the most basic of iman, you understand Allah's made the halal so much. But we need to explain the haram so people then know the haram. That's why we speak about the haram. Not because we want to make the people's lives horrible. Not because we want to make the people's lives black. No. So that the people know what Allah wants from them, what Allah wants them to stay away from, so that they can implement in their life and they can worship Allah Azza wa Jal properly. Simple. Very simple. As for this ayah, I want to mention one point. This ayah obviously is not for the Muslims. This ayah is for the non-Muslims. Okay, that these people that don't understand, you know, when Allah is giving them ayat in the Quran and the Prophet ﷺ is giving them advice, these people, you know, what's wrong with them? It's as if they don't understand. And about the people before us, etc. No one should come and say, because this happened to me recently, no one should come and say, how did the Sheikh use an ayah about the kuffar and he's speaking about the Muslims? This again is a lack of understanding in the deen. We have another rule in Islam. Islam is so much rules, so many rules, but they're beautiful rules for the ones who understand. There's a rule about the Quran, al-ibratu bi'umumi al-lafz la bi-khusus al-sabab. What's taken into consideration is the general meaning of the verse, not the specific reason it was revealed. For example, Allah says, لا يسخر قوم من قوم. One group of people shouldn't laugh and mock at another group of people. That was revealed for a specific reason at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. One group of people mocked and teased another group of people. Do we say today, no, Habibi, you're allowed to tease the other person because that verse was only for the time of the Prophet ﷺ. No. It's about the general wording, the general meaning of the verse. You take it as applicable then and applicable now. Even if it had a specific reason, it was revealed. The Sharia came for all the times and ages and places, not only limited to the time of the Prophet ﷺ, except in very small cases, which is something any in-depth detail. So no one should think that how can a person use a verse or an ayah or a hadith which is talking about the kuffar and use it for the Muslims. It's about for you to get understand the meaning of the verse. It's not saying the Muslim is a kafir. He's saying understand the point of it, that these people, it's as if they don't understand the general speech of the Sharia. As regard to their claim is easy. Now the Sheikh is moving away from the halal haram argument and he's moving to the other claim where people say, the Sharia is easy. The Sharia is easy. Which as we see is true. The Sharia is easy. But the way Sharia made the Sharia easy, not the way you want to make the Sharia easy. As regard to their claim that Islam is easy, this is true, but they are twisting the truth to try and prove something that is false. What is meant by saying that Islam is easy is not that it is in accordance with their desires and opinions, but that it is easy in accordance with that which the Sharia has brought. There is a huge difference between violating prohibitions, by violating prohibitions, by making false claims about Islam being easy, although it is easy beyond any doubt, and availing oneself of legitimate concessions such as, before we get to the examples, to explain that part, he's saying that when these people say Islam is easy, their speech is correct. That statement, Islam is easy, is correct. Allah said it in the Quran. You read Allah bikum al-yusr. Allah wants ease for you. And the Prophet said, Yassiru wa la tu'assiru. Make easy for the people, don't make it hard on the people. Tayyib. What do these people mean by it? And what does Allah and the Prophet mean by their statements? Because if you look at the reality of their speech, hayhat. There's a massive difference between the two. Just like Ali radiallahu anhu when he dealt with the Khawarij. Ali radiallahu anhu, when he was dealing with the Khawarij, those who rebelled against the Islamic State and those who made takfir on the general Muslims and those that made takfir even on Ali radiallahu anhu, when they entered the masjid where Ali was, and they would say to Ali, that you should rule by what Allah revealed. You should judge by what Allah revealed. What did Ali say? Ali rules by what? By what? Yani the Christians revealed? Or by the Buddhist religion? Yani Ali is ruling by what? By the Sharia. Ali said a very eloquent statement. He said, حَقٌ أُرِيدُ بِهِ بَاطِلٍ أُرِيدَ بِهِ بَاطِلٍ أُرِيدَ بِهِ بَاطِلٍ. This statement is a statement of truth, but what's intended by it is falsehood. This statement is a statement of truth, but what's intended by it is falsehood. Just like when these people say, Islam is easy. What do they want to say by Islam is easy? You know, why do you tell the people to put on hijab? Why do you guys say music is haram? Why do you say intermingling is not allowed? Why do you say riba is a major sin? Why do you guys do all of this? That's what they intend. What did Allah intend when he said that the religion is easy? Some examples, such as, and continuing about the concessions and the religion being easy, such as being allowed to join and shorten to prayers, the prayers, to break one's fast when one is traveling, to wipe over the socks when performing wudu, for one day and one night for a resident, and for 3 days and three nights for a traveler, to perform tayammum when one is afraid to use the water, to join two prayers together when one is sick or when rain is falling, to look at a non-mahram woman for the purposes of marriage, to have the choice in the case of making expiation for a broken vow, between freeing a slave or feeding or clothing the poor, to eat the meat of dead animals when necessary, and other kinds of concessions allowed by the Sharia. Meaning what? The Sharia has already made your life easy. The Sharia has already made your life easy. When Allah says He made the religion easy, what does Allah mean? If you can't make wudu, what do you do? Do tayammum. You have to fast Ramadan. But if you're sick, don't fast Ramadan. You're allowed. You're not allowed to see the woman. But when you want to get married, you want to know who you're marrying. So you're allowed to look at the woman who you want to get married to. A person, for example, he's choking. He can't, someone, yani, he's got nothing to, he's got no water or drink to drink for him to get rid of that thing that's stuck in his throat. For example, he steals Rami's bottle and he drinks. Is it halal for me to steal his bottle? It's not. But now I needed it. Different story now. Okay? Or for example, a person was lost. He was lost and there was nothing except for haram meat in front of him. And he's got no, and he's starving. He needs to eat in order to stay alive. He's allowed to eat from the maitah. No problem. This is what the religion says made easy. A person, for example, he's sick. So he knows, for example, he needs to take medicine. He's going to fall asleep at 6 p.m. Aisha still hasn't adhan yet. But he needs to take the medicine, otherwise he's going to get very bad. So he's allowed to pray Maghrib and then bring Aisha forward and pray Aisha after Maghrib, at the time of Maghrib. Even if he's not traveling. But there's a reason. And the Sharia makes it easy for the person. The woman has to wear hijab. But she's, for example, she needs to get to the doctor. There's no female doctors. She's allowed to show the part of the body that needs to be looked at. For example, her forearm or her leg. No problem. You're allowed to reveal that part. Because there's a need. The Sharia has made it easy in and of itself. It's not as these people who say the Sharia is easy but mean falsehood by it, that we make the haram halal, or we don't talk about the haram. When I was, again, you know, we spoke about last week about the whole Wahhabi thing. When we were, you know, growing up, again, we have, unfortunately, in a lot of our cultures, we have a lot of haram things. We have a lot of haram in our cultures, unfortunately. Islam came to promote your culture, but that which is halal. This is called in Arabic, al-urf. وَأْمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ Allah said, and enjoy them that which they know. Yani, if you, in your culture, it's known. For example, when you get married, you eat a certain type of food. Have that food, have no problem. The mahar is usually this amount. Have that amount, no problem. You usually live in a certain type of house, no problem. You have certain type of furniture, all, no problem. This is all halal. But the custom, when it is haram, this is when it's not allowed. This is when the custom is not allowed, when it gets to the haram. So when we were growing up, people used to say, don't be too strict. You say, okay, what do you mean too strict? Too strict in the religion is what? Akhi, did you pray sunnah? You didn't pray sunnah? Get up right now and pray. Akhi, wallah, I'm busy, I have to go. A'udhu billah, what's wrong with you? You didn't pray sunnah? Like, if you walk out, wallah, you're not a good Muslim. That's too strict. Did Allah command him to pray sunnah? Allah didn't command him. If he does it, this is good. And he gets reward. And if he does it, this is between him and Allah. Allah didn't say he has to. There's no sin on him. There's no problem. Especially if he's in a hurry. That's being strict. That's being strict. For example, the little kids are playing. You go up to the kid and you pull him by the ear. Did you memorize 3 pages of Quran today? No? A'udhu billah. How dare you sit and play and you haven't read 3 pages of, you haven't memorized 3 pages of Quran. That's strict. When you make an obligation, something which the Sharia didn't make an obligation. But what's their definition of strict? Yani, when you go to someone's house, if there's a woman, yani, you should shake her hand. Yani, you're not going to commit zina, yani, you should shake her hand. Otherwise, it's being too strict. I think, wow. Wow. A person goes, prays Aisha or Fajr in the masjid. Akhi, you're overdoing it now. It's too much. You think, what's too much? You go up in the masjid, and is the masjid far away, only 1 hour? Okay, maybe it's too much. For a person to go come back, maybe he oppresses himself or his family, maybe. But the masjid is down the road, and he's going to go and come back home. Is he doing his job at work? Yes. Is he taking care of his family? Yes. Is he looking after his body? Yes. What's the issue? What's the issue? One of my friends, he's got like a number one beard, like number one. And he says, the beard, by the way, brothers, in all the madhahib is an obligation. he went number one bid. He went to Lebanon. Unfortunately, we're in some parts of the Muslim world where the colonization was, they made the Sunnah or the Deen disgusting, wal'adhu billah. And their ways, the French way or the English way, this is adab. This is etiquette. So he went and he's got number one bid. Number one. His friends that he grew up with, he lives in Australia now, that he grew up with, they looked at him and said, what do you have a bid for? Why are you getting into too much into the religion? Number one. He said to them, he goes, no, it's not for the religion. He said, astaghfirullah, this is what he said. Astaghfirullah, he goes, I shouldn't have lied. He goes, but I just said it. He goes, no, it's not for the religion. He goes, I have an Italian boss or a Greek boss at work. And he's got a number one bid, so he likes all the workers to have number one bid. He goes, if it's like that, no problem. For the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a'udhu billah. For your boss at work, Yeah, no, it makes sense, it's understandable. This is khalal, this is a deficiency in our understanding of the reality, not just of the deen, of how the dunya should work. So the deen is not hard. If a person implements the deen, he's not strict. This is another thing that they fool the Muslims with today. They say, this person is a moderate Muslim. What's a moderate Muslim? Yani her hijab is like this. And her neck is showing like this. And her hair is showing from here. She's a moderate Muslim. That's a moderate Muslim. In Sharia, is this a good Muslim? This is Habibi, you're not a good Muslim, man. The one that wears hijab like this. We're not saying you're a kafir or going to the hellfire. What we're saying is this is not the Sharia that Islam told the woman to have. This is not the hijab that Islam told the woman to have. When you see like the Muslim guy, for example, all right, he drinks beer. He's got the, Tui's new in front of him. All right, and he's sitting next to Darren and New South Wales scored and cheese and bismillah. He's the moderate Muslim. He's a moderate Muslim. And we love moderate Muslims. Tayyib. What does moderate mean? What does moderate mean? Don't give me a specific definition. I'm not after a dictionary. In general terms, what does moderate mean? Forget, this is what I'm going to say after, don't worry. But in general, when we say moderate, or when we say moderate, it means what? It means a person who's just, a person who's in the middle, a person who's free of extremes. In Islam, you have two extremes. Extreme of being too strict, as we said before. Have you prayed your sunnah prayer? No, you're going to the hellfire. That's too strict. And the other extreme of being no deen. The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is moderate or it's strict? Moderate. Someone who implements the sunnah and implements Islam the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam implemented it, he's moderate or extreme? Moderate. So these people, when they try and fool you by saying this is the moderate Muslim that we want, is it really moderation or is it an extreme of ease? An extreme of leniency. Which Islam said what? You're on the pathway. We don't want to say they're in the hellfire, but on the pathway, wa'l'adhu billah, to the hellfire. So we should be very careful and not be fooled. Not be fooled. Some of the signs, by the way, now of extremism, it was funny when they were reading them out because I fit under every single one except for one. They said if a person wears a thobe, this is a sign of extremism. If he has a beard, a sign of extremism. If he goes to the masjid regularly, a sign of extremism. The niqab is a sign of extremism. What you're saying is everything the Prophet used to do. The only one I didn't have because I don't like it is wearing the watch on the right hand. If you wear the watch on the right hand, this is a sign of extremism. How is wearing a watch on the right hand a sign of extremism? What they mean to say is some, it's not even in Sharia, and it's not fard or haram or mustahab. Some people, they said the Prophet ﷺ used to like doing things on the right. The good things the Prophet used to do on the right. So they say, for example, where you wear a watch, it's easy to have it on the right. Because when you go to the bathroom, when you wipe, akramakumullah, you wipe with your left hand. Yani you want to be able to look at the time and not have any filth on it. So they wear it on the right hand. Okay? So some of the people, they wear the watch on the right hand. They said, this is a sign of extremism. A'udhu billah. What do you mean sunni of extremism? You be very, very careful in not only the Muslims talking about what's strict and not strict based on whims and desires, but even, unfortunately now, non-Muslims telling you and dictating to you which Muslim is a good Muslim and which Muslim is a bad Muslim. The final point which we speak about, like this, so a little bit, not much, inshallah. In addition to the above, the Muslim should realize that one principle underlies all the prohibitions in Islam, that Allah is testing his slave by means of these prohibitions to see what they will do. One of the things that distinguishes the people of the paradise from the people of the hellfire is that the people of the hell indulge in desires with which the fire is surrounded, whereas the people of the paradise will patiently endure the hardships with which the garden is surrounded. Were it not for this test, the obedient will not be distinguished from the disobedient. So when it comes to the halal and haram, this is a test from Allah Azza wa Jal. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسُنُ عَمَلًا. So you see, which of you is best in action? Yani, which are the ones that are going to remain firm in staying in the boundaries of the halal? And which are the ones who are going to indulge in the haram? And he said, and he mentioned the wording, this is a hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, where he said, حُجِبَتْ حِجَاب, covered, حُجِبَتْ النَّارُ بِالشَّهَوَاتِ. The hellfire has been surrounded by desires. Zina, drinking alcohol, backbiting, wasting time. All of this surrounds the hellfire. It's so easy. So easy. وَحُجِبَتِ الْجَنَّةِ بِالْمَكَارِهِ. And the Jannah has been surrounded by hardships. Waking up for Fajr, making wudu when it's cold, restricting yourself from certain food, restricting yourself from going to certain places, the woman wearing hijab, for example, on hot days, you having to lower your gaze, this can cause hardship for a person. Hardship that you can handle, not hardship that is too much for the handle, hardship that you can handle. But the paradise is surrounded by hardship, and the whole fire is surrounded by ease. So this needs more explanation as well, because really, once you're on the path, the path of righteousness becomes easy and the path of hajj of the sin becomes hard. But this is inshallah another time. So if it wasn't for the test of halal and haram, who gets proven that they're worthy of Jannah and who gets proven that they should just get to the hellfire? And if everything was halal and haram, yani why would I come to the masjid if I'm going to get to the Jannah? Like the Christians. Why should I go to church if all I need to do is believe that Jesus is my savior and I go to paradise? Why do I need to go to church? That's why, and you see, for example, Christians, they go to church now in like mini skirts and their cleavage showing. Why? Your grandmothers would never go to church like that. Because to them, it doesn't matter. As long as I believe Jesus is my savior, I'm going anyway. All of the boys, they get tattoos of crosses and macrosses. But to them, in their Bible, it says they shouldn't get tattoos. But they do it because they're going to paradise anyway. I'm not going to the hellfire. This is where a lot of these priests started to come in now. Huh? You go confess your sin. Go tell the priest, I slept with a child. No problem. Go home, pray, you're forgiven. You know, by the way, by law, the confessions, if a person comes and confesses to a priest and it's a crime, the priest doesn't have to say to the government. And if a person comes and says to the priest, I slept with three children, I sexually molested them, walayadu billah, the police doesn't have to tell the law, doesn't have to tell the police. And he's protected with that. There's laws that protect him from that, which now they're trying to change. They're trying. But that's all it is. Go to a priest, confess your sin in some particular part of Christianity, and you're forgiven. That's it. Why? Because you believe Jesus is your savior. Gone, finished. Islam, it's not like that. It's not khalas, la ilaha illallah muhammadullah, enter the Jannah. Man qala la ilaha illallah muhammadullah, man qala la ilaha sadiqan. With truthfulness, dakhala al-jannah, we entered paradise. Truthfulness means what? With action. So Allah is testing the slaves with the halal haram. Who is upright, who listens, who obeys, who withholds for my sake, and who is opposite, who's the one that lets himself go, so that Allah Azza wa Jal places justly the people to go into the paradise and the people to go, wal'adhu billah, in the hellfire. People of faith look at the difficulties involved. Listen, brothers. People of faith, and people with iman, look at the difficulties involved from the perspective of the reward that they will earn by pleasing Allah. So obedience becomes easy for them. When a person's religious and he upholds the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal, he looks at it now, khalas, I'm doing it for the sake of Allah. And when you do something for the sake of Allah, it becomes easy. It becomes easy. And he, for example, a person's a millionaire. He's going to give his zakat money. His zakat might be $100,000, $150,000. He takes it out and he says, here's $150,000. No problem. Why? Because if he's religious, he has iman, khalas, you know, this is for the sake of Allah. I have no problem. Because I know it's getting me closer to Allah. I know it's pleasing Allah. I know it's getting rid of my sins. I know it's getting me closer to Jannah. So it becomes easy. You know, when you love someone, everything becomes easy when you love someone. For example, a person loves his wife. Who's newly married here? No one, anyone newly married? Because the love fades away after a few years. Rami, you're looking, huh? Hey, inshallah, huh? When you find the girl that you love, in the halal way, of course, you find the girl that you love. After work now, you want to go home and you're asleep because you're tired. When you're in love, habibi, after work, no matter how mqassar you are, I have to go see her. I have to go. So you get to her house and you spend hours. And you go to work the next day, no problem. If one of your friends wants to message you and talk to you on the phone, you're like, bro, kahish, all right, 10 minutes, yani, what else do you want from me? Yalla, alhamdulillah, I'm good, you're good, yalla, assalamu alaikum, bye-bye. We'll go fishing on the weekend, inshallah, bye. And that's it. You hang up the phone. When you're in love and it's halal, 2-3 hours, 4 hours at night time, every night, no problem whatsoever. You stay and you talk, no problem. Spending money, for example, you buy your mate, all right, I'll buy you a box of chocolate one day, I'll buy you, yani, I'll shout you a meal, yani, one day, once a week, مثلاً, once a month. When she's your wife and you love her, roses and a car and furniture, you just command and taht amrik. Whatever you want, I'm going to do. The brothers that are smiling are the ones that are in love. So they do it. Because it's easy for them. Why? Because they're in love. When it comes to the person doing ibadah for Allah Azza wa Jal, even if he finds it hard, wallah, he loves doing it. It's coming to Fajr. If you look at it from a non-Muslim perspective, you wake up at 5 o'clock in order to come to Fajr and then go back home and get ready and go to work. It's not easy, but it's done. For you to not commit zina, or not take drugs, or not smoke, from a non-Muslim perspective, this is impossible. How can you not eat bacon? How can you? From a Muslim perspective, alhamdulillah, it's easy. Because it says this for the sake of Allah, it becomes easy. You say to him, just like you, if you want to go to the gym, every day you can go to the gym, work out, and your body goes through pain, but you love that pain that you go through. Why? Because it's in the sake of you going to gym. Go look at a fisherman. A fisherman, he's got, $3,000-$4,000 worth of rods and reels, if not more. He goes fishing maybe 2-3 times a week. He stands there with a line in the water waiting for a fish 2-3 hours, even if there's no bite. Doesn't matter, you gotta wait. You gotta wait, akhi, you gotta wait for the right one. And you're thinking, look, gosh, man, let's just go to sleep or something. All right? But he's waiting and he's happy. Why? Because he loves fishing. And when a person loves Allah Azza wa Jal, these things become easy for him. As for the hypocrites, on the other hand, they view these difficulties as a matter of pain, suffering, and deprivation. So obedience becomes a heavy burden on them. By foregoing what is prohibited, the obedient person gains much more. Whoever forsakes something for the sake of Allah, Allah will compensate him with something better, and he will enjoy the sweet taste of faith in his heart. The person who goes through, the one who doesn't have that iman, he finds it difficult. He finds it difficult. I can't. Come to the masjid. You look at Ramadan. Masjid is full at the first night. This year was even, they didn't even wait to the next 10 days. A few days after the beginning of Ramadan, 4th, 5th day, the lines halved. Halved in some masjid. After 3 or 4 days. Well, we're not saying that they're hypocrites. We're saying they're weakness of iman. Khalas. It's too hard. Huh? After Ramadan, back to normal. 1-2 lines in the masjid. Khalas. Why? Because the one that doesn't have that iman, why should I just stay, relax, watch TV, I'm tired. But you were fasting the whole day, and you would come at night. It's easier for you to come now. He doesn't have that iman. doesn't have that iman. He says it's hard. To a person about the bid, it's hard. To a person who gives zakat, I worked hard for this money. To a person, his wife, yani, to look for a righteous wife, but I want something that, yani, that his eye is pleased with. It's hard. This is weak iman. That's why you see it as hard. Told me now, come, let's go for a 10-kilometer jog. I told you, it's hard. It's not what I want. It's not what I want. Told me now, let's go play a game of footy. I'll say, okay, yeah, let's go. I'll go play a game of footy because it's something that I like. But to go for a jog, heck, I'll 40, 10 kilometers. Why? I'd rather read a book or something. Something that you like, you'll do. Something that you don't like, you won't do. The deen, once you start to love the deen, you know Allah, you know why you're religious, you know why the deen is important, you know the consequences of leaving it. Alhamdulillah, the deen becomes easy for you. And the opposite is true. And whoever leaves something for the sake of Allah, Allah blesses him with that which is better. The Prophet said, "Man taraka shay'an lillah, awadahu Allah khayran minhu." Whoever leaves something for the sake of Allah, Allah will give him something better than it. You look at people that had a haram job. He left that haram job. Even after, it might have been a test, big test, but Allah gave him something better. See someone who was about to go after haram women. He said, "La, I need to fix myself." So he left the haram. Allah blessed him with, alhamdulillah, a blessed wife. For example, whoever leaves something for the sake of Allah, Allah blesses him with that which is better. Just, yani, very quickly, this paper, yani, this risala, this book that the Sheikh has written, hafizahullah, says this paper discusses a number of prohibitions that have been proven in Sharia based on evidences from the Quran and the Sunnah. Some scholars have grouped the prohibitions under headings such as al-kaba'ir or major sins. Among the best books on the topic is Tanbih al-Ghafilin an A'mal al-Jahilin by Ibn al-Nahas al-Damashqi. I don't know if that book is translated, but there's other books on major sins, etc. So everyone writes in their certain way. In this book, the Sheikh is gathering general sins that are there in order for that people commit a lot. So he wants to talk about our time and things that happen a lot that people belittle. As for other books, and it may be a bigger book or something specific to major sins, then you find them in their own headings and their own books and their own bookshelves. You will find, especially the newer mashayikh, contemporary mashayikh, because a lot of my influence now by the university way of writing. So when you want to write a thesis, etc., you write, part of what you write is the other books that are there on the topic. So you find that a lot of them, because they went through, you know, their bachelor's and their master's and their doctorate in Sharia, so you find that a lot of their writings also include this. And the ulama previously, they used to write a lot of this, but in the actual book itself. As for, again, a book like this, they start to write it nowadays a lot at the beginning. Whoever wants more, let him get to this book, or you'll find a lot of benefits in this book, etc. And this is part of the barakah of ilm. Part of the barakah of ilm, as the ulama say, is for you to attribute the statement to its sayer. Yani, if you hear a nice statement, don't put it up as if it's your own statement. Or try and find out. Say, this scholar said, but one of the ulama said, and you put the statement. So if you, for example, in writing, a scholar benefits a lot from a particular book. So he'll write, and whoever wants for any greater reading, let him go back to this book. And this is part of the barakah of ilm. And finally, these prohibitions include actions which are widely practiced by many Muslims by mentioning them. So now the Sheikh is giving you the reason he's written this. By mentioning them, my intention is to correct and advise people. I ask Allah to guide me and my Muslim brothers and to help us adhere to the limits which He has set and to avoid the things that He has prohibited and to save us from our evil deeds. And Allah is the best to guard, and He is the most merciful of those who show mercy. You know, the whole intention of this book is to advise and to help guide the Muslims. So this is our intention by teaching, and our intention by the brothers that learn, for you to, inshallah, be able to assist others in their guidance. You have the book, you have the evidence there. So when you speak to people in a manner of wisdom, a manner which is wise, and you have, alhamdulillah, the proof there in case anyone needs it. So this is the author, hafizullah's intention, and this should be our intention when we read and when we learn, to benefit ourselves by staying away from the haram, and then after that, inshallah, to benefit others هذا والله أعلم وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آل محمد
فبالله كم تستطب القروح ويبرأ جروح الكسير الجريح وينشط ذاك السقيم العليل وقد كان بالسقم دهرا طريح.